thanks for taking the time to talk with me today.
Glad to be here. Thank you.
Emily, how many Senate races has Ballotpedia identified as battleground general election races so far?
Well, of the 35 Senate seats up for election this year, including two special elections in Minnesota and Mississippi, we expect 12 will be battlegrounds. 8 of those seats are currently held by Democratic incumbents. We have Bill Nelson in Florida, Joe Donnelly in Indiana, Tina Smith in Minnesota in the seat that was previously held by Al Franken. We also have Claire McCaskill in Missouri, John Tester in Montana, Heidi Heitkamp in North Dakota, Sherrod Brown in Ohio, and Joe Manchin in West Virginia.
Wow. Every cycle, political writers talk about how one party or the other has an advantage, depending on which Senate seats are up for election. Does either party have that in 2018?
I would say Republicans have the advantage with this year's election map. They only need to, across all Senate races, defend 8 seats. And we've identified 4 of those that will be battlegrounds. Jeff Flake's open seat in Arizona, Dean Heller in Nevada, Bob Corker's open seat in Tennessee, and Ted Cruz in Texas. Now, all these races will be critical for both parties as Democrats attempt to take control of the Senate, where they currently are in the minority, 49-51, if you include the 2 independent senators who caucus with them.
And with such a small current Republican majority in the Senate, there isn't much margin for error for either party. Generally speaking, how does Ballotpedia identify what it believes to be the most important general election races?
Well, we take a look at 6 factors that can signal how competitive a race will be. The first is the margin of victory in the previous election, particularly those races where the margin of victory was 10% or less. For example, Democrat John Tester in Montana won his 2012 re-election bid by just 4 points, and he is already facing vocal opposition from Donald Trump for playing a role in the failed nomination of Trump's VA secretary pick, Ronnie Jackson, last month. We also consider the margin of victory in the state in past presidential elections. Across the Senate map as a whole this year, Democrats are defending 10 seats that Donald Trump won in the 2016 presidential election. And there's only one Republican incumbent representing a state won by Hillary Clinton, and that is Dean Heller in Nevada.
10 Democratic incumbents in states won by Donald Trump, some of them by very large margins. That is a tough map for them.
Absolutely. And a third factor impacting the map this year is whether the seat is open or not. An open seat, as you'd expect, is more vulnerable for a partisan flip than one in which the incumbent is seeking re-election. And we will see this play out in Tennessee, where Bob Corker is retiring, and in Arizona with Jeff Flake.
So length of time in office plays a role then?
That's right. A freshman incumbent is naturally going to be more vulnerable than a longstanding member of the Senate. And Democrats are hoping to take advantage of that in a state like Texas, which by any measure is a red state. The last Democratic senator left office in 1993, but there is a Democratic challenger who has shown some fundraising chops, Beto O'Rourke. He ended the first quarter of 2018 with more cash on hand than freshman incumbent Ted Cruz. So absolutely, tenure in office is a fourth factor.
All right. Are there any other factors?
We also look to outside race raters like the Cook Political Report. And finally, we consider the non-quantitative elements of an election. Is the election going to feature a rematch of candidates who faced off in 2012? Has the incumbent been subject to scrutiny for a scandal or made an unpopular vote in the Senate? We take into account any special circumstances like this that could change the course of the election.
That's a lot to consider, but it's all very, very important. Do you use that same criteria to determine which House races will be competitive?
We do. We look at the same historical election trends just at the congressional district level. We've seen a significant number of incumbents not seeking re-election this year and retirements in the House, 54 altogether now, which has put some unexpected seats in play.
Unlike in the Senate, where only about a third of the seats are up for election each cycle, the House of Representatives is different. All 435 U.S. House seats are up for election every 2 years. At this time, how many U.S. House seats has Ballotpedia marked as battlegrounds in November?
We have currently identified 44 House races as battlegrounds, but it is possible that will change depending on who wins in primaries this summer. And unlike the Senate map, where Republicans are at a distinct advantage, most of these battleground House seats are currently held by Republican incumbents, 32 in total. Another 9 seats are held by the Democrats. And then we have the unusual situation of Pennsylvania, whose congressional map was just redrawn earlier this year. We consider 3 of these newly created districts to be battlegrounds, the 1st, the 7th, and the 17th in Pennsylvania, but we don't identify them as being under the control of either party because they are new.
Yes, Pennsylvania has been a fascinating and disrupting situation. What with the state Supreme Court requiring that all of the congressional district boundaries in that state be redrawn just before candidates had to file for election. Emily, now that you've highlighted what criteria Ballotpedia uses to define those competitive races, which congressional battlegrounds do you expect to be especially interesting?
We are closely following the Senate race in Florida. It has a late summer primary on August 28th, but we expect term-limited Governor Rick Scott to easily win the Republican Party's nomination. And he brings with him name recognition in the state and a well of financial resources. In 2010, for example, he spent $75 million to win the governor's mansion and has already spent $8 million on the Senate race this year. Satellite groups have been spending in this race $4 million to attack three-term incumbent Bill Nelson. So we could be looking at one of the most expensive Senate races of the midterms. Florida is also interesting because although Nelson won his 2012 re-election bid by 13 points, he is the only Democrat elected to statewide office, and Trump won the state. It was a close one. The margin was just over 1 percentage point, but this is definitely a purple state.
Florida certainly has a history of very close elections. Another interesting fact about Florida Senate seats, the state has had one U.S. senator from each party for 32 of the last 38 years, going back to 1980. And the last time the state had two Republican senators at the same time was in the 1870s. Mm. So with Marco Rubio winning re-election in 2016, if Rick Scott wins, it would definitely reverse that trend. What about the open seat in Arizona?
Well, Arizona is another state with a late summer primary on August 28th, but this race is already beginning to shape up. On the Democratic side, we have Kyrsten Sinema, who currently represents Arizona's 9th congressional district. She leapt to the front of the field early with support from the Democratic Senatorial Campaign Committee, and she has been described as moderate and even GOP-friendly, which could play well in a purple state that went for Trump by 4 points. On the Republican side, there are 3 prominent candidates. Former Maricopa County Sheriff Joe Arpaio, who you may remember was pardoned by Trump last year. There is also Congresswoman Martha McSally, who appears to be Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell's pick for the seat. And also running is Arizona State Senator Kelly Ward. It's important to remember that this is an open seat in a region of the country that has shown some movement to the left, but it will still be a tough and expensive battle for the party.
Indeed. I know Democrats would love to finally win a U.S. Senate seat in Arizona, where there has not been a Democratic senator for almost 25 years. We mentioned that about a quarter of states have already held their primaries in the Senate. Are there any races where the outcome of the primaries may have an impact on the general election?
I think so. What what we have seen is that in some races, the general election candidates are quite different than what might have been predicted this time last year. Take Indiana, where two U.S. representatives with seven-figure campaigns were defeated by businessman and state legislator Mike Braun, who largely self-funded his campaign and was able to successfully present himself as an outsider candidate. And Democratic incumbent Joe Donnelly is going to face a tough re-election battle against Braun in Indiana because Donald Trump won that state by 19 points in 2016.
And that's where Vice President Mike Pence is from as well.
Yeah, exactly. And another state we're looking at that the White House can make a difference in is West Virginia. In this race, we have a longtime West Virginia political figure in incumbent Joe Manchin, who before being elected to the U.S. Senate served as a state legislator, state secretary of state, and governor. But West Virginia is also the most Trump-friendly state in the nation. Trump won it by a margin of 42 points. The Republican candidate in this race is State Attorney General Patrick Morrissey, who defeated Congressman Evan Jenkins and former coal exec Don Blankenship in a really aggressive primary with significant spending from satellite groups.
Isn't Blankenship still going to try for that seat?
That's right. Blankenship is going to try to run as a Constitution Party candidate in the general, but it's not clear whether that will be legally possible. West Virginia has what some describe as a sore loser law on the books, which would prohibit a candidate who lost a major party primary from running for the same seat again as a third party candidate. But some legal commentators and Blankenship himself are challenging that reading of the law. And ultimately, Blankenship's re-entry into the fray of this race would turn what could be a competitive race for Republicans into a tough three-way contest.
That Republican primary on May 8th involving Blankenship in West Virginia was such a bitter battle. It will be very interesting to see how that develops as we go forward. Emily, you talked about incumbent Democratic senators facing really difficult re-elections. There's also been discussion about Republican House incumbents who will face tough re-election races. Can you discuss any specific examples of that?
Yes. In Virginia's 10th congressional district, that's a swing district that backed Romney in 2012 by a margin of 2 points before flipping for Hillary Clinton in 2016, where she won by 10 points. And incumbent Barbara Comstock is already facing attacks from Democratic candidates who are challenging her in particular on her position on firearms regulation and her A rating from the NRA. Now, the Democratic field is quite large, though, in Virginia's 10th, so we won't know who her challenger will be until later this month on June 12th. In Utah's 4th, we see Republican incumbent Mia Love facing a competitive Democratic challenger in Salt Lake County Mayor Ben McAdams. Polling has shown that his approval rating as mayor surpasses Love's approval rating as a member of the House, and both candidates have roughly the same amount of cash on hand right now. So that could be a competitive race.
Yes, that fourth district in the Salt Lake City area in Utah is pretty new. It was only created after the 2010 census, and it was first represented by a Democrat, Jim Matheson. So if the Democrats retake that seat, that wouldn't be totally out of the question. We've also seen some prominent Democratic candidates who are veterans. Are there any of those that are particularly notable?
Well, Democrats have been fielding quite a few veteran candidates this election cycle, most notably and successfully in Pennsylvania's old 18th congressional district, where former Marine Connor Lamb won a special election there in what had typically been a safe red seat. And we have in Kentucky's 6th, Marine Corps Lieutenant Colonel Amy McGrath rising to prominence with campaign videos that highlighted her military experience, which she then used to build a national fundraising network from that exposure. And what's particularly interesting about Kentucky's 6th and McGrath is that she defeated in the Democratic primary the candidate the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee had encouraged to run, Lexington Mayor Jim Gray. But it's going to be a tough battle for her in November against incumbent Andy Barr. He easily won re-election by double-digit margins in 2014 and 2016. And this is a pretty conservative district based in central Kentucky.
Democrats held Kentucky 6 for a long time before Barr won it in 2012. I think Ben Chandler was the Democratic representative for quite a few terms, and they keep trying to win it back. But as you say, that is a very difficult area now for Democrats to perform well. Where would we find some vulnerable Democratic seats in the House?
We have Minnesota's 8th congressional district, where incumbent Rick Nolan is not seeking re-election. He had won by a hair in 2016, while Trump took the district by 15 points. So even without Minnesota's 8th being an open seat, Republicans were looking at it for a pickup opportunity. There are two more open seats in New Hampshire's 1st and Minnesota's 1st, which will be tough for Democrats. And Nevada's 3rd is another potentially vulnerable seat. Incumbent Jackie Rosen, who is the likely Democratic nominee for U.S. Senate in Nevada, also leaves behind an open seat in that district.
This has been some really great information, Emily. Now that we've talked about remarkable general election races, there are still lots more primaries to come in 2018, with almost 20 states holding them in the month of June. A very big date is this coming Tuesday, June 5th. What primaries are you most interested in on that date, and how will the outcome of those races impact the general election?
Well, on Tuesday, we will see primaries in Alabama, California, Iowa, Mississippi, Montana, New Jersey, New Mexico, and South Dakota. So you're absolutely right that it is a very heavy election day across the entire country. We will be watching Republican primaries in the Senate race in Montana, New Jersey's 5th, and New Mexico's 2nd. And on the Democratic side, we're looking at New Mexico's 1st and New Jersey's 11th. But it's California where we expect to see the most interesting results. The state uses a top two primary system where all candidates appear on the same primary ballot regardless of partisan affiliation. This can lead to a top two shutout in which two candidates from a single party advance to the general election, meaning that that party will hold the seat regardless of which candidate wins in November. And Democrats face the possibility of top two shutouts in 5 House races. And they are critical races since they all feature a Republican incumbent representing a district that was carried by Hillary Clinton in 2016. To try to prevent this from happening, we have seen Democratic candidate withdrawals, the party trying to coalesce around one candidate, and some major satellite spending in these races. So I would keep an eye on Rice's open seat in the 39th, Rohrabacher's seat in the 48th, and Daryl Issa's open seat in the 49th.
All very good stuff, Emily. We've kind of gotten to the end of what we had planned on talking about, but if you don't mind, we did get a viewer question that I wanted to put you on the spot, and that is with regard to the West Virginia Senate primary. How do you feel that the negativity of that race and even Blankenship's possible entry to it will impact Morrissey's chances against Joe Manchin?
Well, we saw in that race both Republican and Democratic parties using super PACs to get involved. And so we've seen a definite interest, certainly on the Republican side, from trying to flip it. So I see it being a place where a lot of money is spent just because of how huge the margin of victory was for Trump in 2016. Morrissey did win by a decent margin in that race, so he appears to be relatively popular within his own party. So it'll just be interesting to see how it plays out and whether Blankenship is indeed able to be on the ballot in November.
Yeah, there's going to be quite a few television commercials on TV, on the airwaves in West Virginia. So I bet the residents there better be prepared for a lot of political commercials as we head through the fall. Thank you so much for all this information, Emily. It certainly figures to be a fascinating remainder of the primary season.